Hi everyone. So today's topic is exception handling. Exception handling is the process of responding to the occurrence of exception that occur during the execution of a program. And it is a very important concept in RPA. We must categorize all our exception really well and the actions that are associated with each type of exception so that these exceptions or error does not lead to an abrupt end of our process. So let's get started. So we'll be covering a very new concept that has been introduced to handle the exception in UiPath, and I'm talking about Global Exception Handler. So what all we'll be covering today is, what is Global Exception Handler? How do we use them in our UiPath workflow? How to retry, ignore, or abort an activity in case an exception occurs? And how to identify that which activity has thrown an exception so that the concerned team can then directly look into that activity or can directly look into that workflow to fix that instead of wasting their time in the whole process. So what is Global Exception Handler? Global Exception Handler is the type of workflow designed to handle exception. Whenever an error occurs in your workflow, it is redirected to the Global Exception Handler to handle it. And then the Global Exception Handler takes decision accordingly. So it's like whenever you create this Global Exception Handler, you get a predefined file or workflow, you can say, already created. The same that works while we deal in with RE framework, that whenever we choose that template, we already have a predefined structure and we can obviously edit and manipulate them according to our process. So Global Exception Handler is also the same, that you get a predefined thing in which you can modify and manipulate things according to your need. It is to be defined only once and it executes every time an exception occurs. But the point to note here is that the main entry point cannot act as entry point of Global Exception Handler, which means that your main file or your entry point file, you can call it as main.xaml or from wherever your this process is starting, you cannot mark that thing as a Global Exception Handler. Because your process cannot start with an exception. If something has happened already in your project or even a single click has been performed by your process, then obviously from there, if there is any error or if it's success or if it's business rule exception or any sort of exception, the Global Exception Handler can just pick up from there. So these are the four main options which we get in Global Exception Handler and we can accordingly use them. So the first one is abort. So from the name, it's very clear that it stops the process or it aborts the process. Retry, it retries the current activity a certain number of time and that certain number of time or the count, you can obviously make it configurable. Ignore, ignores the exception and executes the next activity, acts like nothing happened before. Continue, it runs the Global Exception Handler workflow. So must for Global Exception Handler is whenever you create, you have a project.json file already created, whenever you create any project, any template in UiPath. So if you just open the project.json file, what you have is, this is the key, exception handler workflow, then colon, and the value of that key is the path where your Global Exception Handler has been created or is placed. So to get more clarification, let's see a demo of how all this works so that it's more clear. So this is a XAML. I have a global handler already created and we'll just see what all modifications we can do. So the first prior thing is if you have to create a global exception handler, you'll just have to go to new and you get an option here to create a global handler. So once you click on it, I already have it created, but once you click on it, you have it here. So I'm getting one as the name because I already have it, but obviously you can rename it to whatever name you want to. And your global exception handler is created. So if I just create it, I'll just show what all basic things you get in global handler. So as you create it, you will get this log error thing already here in place. And you'll have this, choose your next behavior. Let's just create and see the basic thing which you get. So if I just create, let's go to project. So you have this thing already in place. Your next behavior you can choose. And as I've told you, these are the four major behavior: continue, ignore, retry, and abort. So this is what you get. I'll delete this thing as for now because I already have the global handler in place, and we'll see. So also, you can have only one global handler in your program. So because I already had, this was created, but you see the difference between the icons. So this is what actually a global handler icon is. You do not get that UI icon which you usually get in all your workflows, but instead you get this round thing which denotes that it's a global handler. Okay. And also, if you just click on this file, you can set this as global handler. So that's what where the point to be noted comes in, that you cannot make your entry point or your main.xaml to be set as global handler, because then obviously that's not logically correct. So I have here a test file. What if you do not handle the exception well in your use case? So what happens? It leads to an abrupt end of your process. Nobody gets notified and it just ends everywhere. So usually what's the best practice is that you end your process at a logical end. Even if you have got any exception, if it's a business one, then the business needs to be notified. If it's not a business one, if it's a system exception due to some selector not found or some sites on which the process has to work on is down and like that, then obviously the concern team, maybe the support team or any team, they must be notified that, okay, this particular process has failed. So if you just keep writing down your code without handling the exception, it would just lead to an abrupt end of the process, which shouldn't be the case. So I have here this input dialog box, and we'll see how global handler actually works. I'm saying that enter a number between 1 and 2, and I've taken the result in a number int, which is a variable of type int, integer. And I've just printed it, and over here I'm catching the exception. So this is exception, which is system exception, and here I'm catching the business rule exception. So just to showcase that how the exceptions are categorized and how they should be handled, if I say, or if I define a business rule here that, okay, if a number is greater than or equal to 1 and it is less than or equal to 20, then it's fine. But if somebody is entering a number not in the range of 1 to 20, then throw a business exception, because that's not the business, it's not satisfying the business rule. So I'll say here that throw a business exception. And how do we throw any type of exception if we want to? If we want to throw system exception, if you want to throw null reference exception or any sort of exception. So how do we throw that? So we throw by writing new and then writing business rule exception. And then here in the string in double quotes, we mention in our message that what's the message. So I'll say number does not fall in range. Okay. So I have thrown a business exception with a message that this number, which the user has entered, does not fall in range. So throw an exception. Now, as I have thrown an exception here, so it would go to catch. If there is any exception in the try block, it gets catched in the catch block. So it would, because I have thrown a business rule exception and I'm catching two type of exceptions, so this is what we call as the categorizing of the exception. So it would go to the catch of business rule exception. And here what I'm doing is I'm just, printing it down or displaying it in message box that this is my exception message. From here in, I can obviously send in a mail to client denoting that the program has failed because of this reason, or I can write it to a status file that this particular item has failed because of this reason. So according to the process, you can definitely write a set of code which has to be performed in case of exception. So as the try block throws an exception and catch block catches it, also it passes the control to the global handler, because this is what the global exception handler work is. It handles the exception. So it would take the control wherever an exception comes in. So the architecture which you're getting it, it is just, logging that error info.exception.toString. So it would log your exception. What else can you do is that, you can just drag in a right line. There are a lot of things, a lot of information which you can display here. So if I say I want to know that which particular activity has thrown this exception, so I can do this error info dot exception dot name. Okay, let me check. I can even, you know the type. What sort of exception is this? It's a null reference exception. It's an argument not found exception. It's a system exception. It's a business exception. So if I say get type dot to string, so I'll get to know the type of exception it is. Once I get to know the type of exception it is, then I can take I can decide on the action which has to be performed. So suppose in case of business exception, I just want the business to be notified and the bot to do the rest of the work. But in case of system exception, I want the bot to retry. And once the maximum retry number is reached, then I want the process to be aborted or to be stopped, notifying the support team. Okay. So how can I do that? So if you see, you already get two type of variables here created. One is the retry, which is your maximum retry count. You can obviously make this configurable. You can save this in config, or you can, you know, define the maximum retry count you want to use. If you want to, you know, retry your particular thing 10 times, you just write 10 here and it will be retried 10 times. So ideally it is retried 2 or 3 times. So I'll say retry 2 times. And you get this answer here, in which I think you can store any of your thing, like you want to store that which activity ID has thrown exception or which activity has thrown exceptions accordingly. You can write this thing here. It takes in two things, error info. So the exception takes in what info is there. So from the catch, it gets this and it outs this thing. So this error action is that whether you want to abort, you want to continue, want to ignore. So those are the error actions. So I am saying that error info.retry count, if it's less than 3. So then what I'm going to do, if it's less than 3, then keep on retrying. If it exceeds 3, or if it's 3, then abort. But I want this to be performed only in case of system exception. I don't want the retry to be performed in case of business exception. So what I can do here is I drag in an if. I can obviously manipulate this according to my need. So my process says that in case of business exception, you abort it right away. No need to retry. So I'll say, okay, if this contains business rule exception. Okay, so then I need not to even check that what's the retry count or anything like that. If it's the case of business rule exception, I want to abort it right away. So what I will do is I will assign the action argument to be aborted. If it's not a business exception, then I want to check then if it's a system exception and whether the retry has been performed or not. So then I'll go here if it's not a business exception. So if I'm only categorizing it two ways, system exception or business exception, then I can do it this way. If I'm categorizing it in more than two ways, then what I can do is I can have an if here and I can even check that, okay, if it's not a business exception, then whether it is argument not found exception or it is system exception. And accordingly, I can take action. So as of now, I'm having only two things. If it's not business exception, then it has to be system exception. So I'm checking that whether retry count is less than 3 or not. If it's less than 3, then okay, you retry. If it has exceeded the maximum retry count, then you abort. Okay. So this is what change I have done here. Okay, and also if I want to have the activity name, there is some function for that also. Let's check it. So source also, you get the source that from where the exception has originated. So you can even, you know, print in this thing. So let's print this also and let's see what's the output.
Also, let's see if we get to know the function or the method for get so that we get the this thing activity name. So the message is that whenever we throw an exception, we write new business rule exception, and we have written that okay, this is that the number does not fall in range. So that is exception message. So you can even print that thing. Okay. We'll see how to, you know, print in the activity name. So as for now, let's try executing this thing and see. Okay. So I go here and I'll run. I'll pass a value which does not fall in the range, and we'll see that how does this thing reacts to it. Okay. So let's click on OK. And yeah, good to go. Let's click on OK. Execute. So I've run it on debug mode, so that's why it's taking a lot of time. Okay, so here I'm going to enter a number that does not fall in the range. Okay, so suppose I enter 25. I have run it in debug mode, so you will be able to see how the flow goes. Okay, so let's enter 25 and it will go to this throw. So we have reached here. Now what is going to happen that once the error is there in the try block, so it would go to the catch block. Okay, so let's click on continue, or we can, you know, do this step into. So it went to the catch block, and then from there the control was passed to the global exception handler. So if we see this log error thing, so the whole exception has been printed. Okay, now if we just step into, we will get to know the type, and we know what is the type. We know the type is business rule exception. So you see here it's written uipath.core.businessruleexception. Okay, let's step into, and this would turn out to be true because it is a business rule exception. So it would return true. And as it returns true, what are we going to do? We are going to just abort. Okay. So it will abort. So a process would just simply stop. If I click on continue, it will stop. Okay. Now what? Now let's try doing this thing that we will pass something. We will throw an system exception. Okay. So if I click on run file, so this time we are throwing system exception. So I'll not be passing an integer. I'll be passing this thing. So it has retried. So that's why it's asking me again. So if I just open this thing and I go to output, so see, it has thrown an exception, but it has retried. So again, because our maximum retry count is 2, I'm again going to pass something wrong and it will retry again. And again, I'm going to pass something wrong. And it is saying that it's not valid for valid value for int 32, and it will stop the process. Okay. So see, if we now look at this thing. Okay, so it has started, but it's saying that this is not a valid value for int 32. Input string was not in a correct format. So because we're logging the whole exception message, so it has logged the whole exception message here. Okay, and scrolling down, and we've logged the type of exception. So it has logged that, okay, it's a system exception, and again it's retrying. Okay, so that's the one retry. This is the second retry, and that's it. Then it stopped the execution. Let me drag it. Okay, we can even, you know, print in the retry count so that it's more clear to us. So we gave it wrong and it retried for the first time. Okay. And if we just crawl down, it retried for the second time. And then because maximum retry was reached, so it stopped. Okay. So that is how this global exception handler helps us.
So now if I want to just ignore the exception and move ahead. So suppose if I have entered a number, a wrong number, or maybe a wrong data type, that is if it's asking for an integer and I've entered a string variable, and I want to just ignore the exception so that all other tasks gets executed. So if I go to global exception handler, so if it's a business rule exception, I'm aborting it anyway. And now if it's not a business rule exception, I don't want it to retry. I just simply want it to keep executing it, keep executing the next statement and ignoring the exception. So I've just commented it out. If it's a business rule, it will get aborted. If it's not a business rule exception, then what I want to do is that I just ignore. Okay. And let's run it now and see. So if it has ignored, so then it must print this message box that, okay, you have completed. Okay. So, and let me just comment this thing also so that it does not go in the else statement of this, because if I'm entering a wrong thing, which does not fall in 1 to 20, then it would go in else and it would throw a business exception. But we want to check that how the ignore thing would perform. So we'll just disable it for now and run this thing. Let's check where is our input dialog box. So it has already, you know, come up here. Okay, and let's try entering a wrong thing. So I have entered a string type, which would obviously be a system exception. So I'll click on OK. And it has ignored this thing. So if you see, this is where the exception must have occurred, and it has occurred. If you open the logs, you will see that there is an exception. But because I have to ignore the exception so that the next activity gets executed, so it has ignored the exception and it has executed, you have completed, and it would then log this thing that the number is this. So if I go here, so it is saying the number is 0 because the default value of an integer type variable is 0. So it has printed that the number is 0. So this is how the ignore thing is behaved. Ignore type of action behaves. And if I want to just continue, so I can even do that thing that in error action, I write in, instead of ignore, I write in continue. So it would continue with that exception. So that is how you can manipulate this global exception handler so that you can accordingly make use of it and handle all the exception really well and categorize them and take the actions associated with each type of exception. This is how you print in the activity name, that which activity has thrown the exception. So it's error info.activity info.name. Instead of name, you can even have the ID printed and like that. Okay. So if I open the output panel, I'll see that it has printed that, okay, input dialog activity has thrown in the error. I can print in the retry count. I can increase the retry count. I can decrease the retry count. I can make it configurable by storing it in config. And also, as I've told, that the project.json thing would have a key and value pair associated with global exception handler. If it's not there, then you must add it there. Then only the global exception handler would perform the way it has to perform. So if I just go and open the project.json file, so you see here, there's this runtime thing here. So you have runtime options.
And inside that you have exception handler workflow, which is the key name, and global handler dot XAML, which is the value of this key. So if you're, because I am having the global handler dot XAML in my root directory, so there's no path associated with it. But if you're not having it in the root directory, then this value must contain the entire path to global handler dot XAML for your program to execute the way the global handler should behave. So that's all for this video. Put global handler in your process and categorize the exception well so that your program does not lead to an abrupt end. Thanks for watching the video, and please don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. Happy learning.